Impurities. The FDA requires testing for impurities to qualify things to get into drug products. And I want to give you just a little bit of history here, kind of another groaner in terms of how this all came about. In 1937, elixir sulfanilamide was formulated in diethylene glycol with raspberry flavoring. Diethylene glycol, because it dissolved, and they were had this all set up to give it to children. As you know, the diethylene glycols are antifreezes, and they're quite toxic. However, they didn't test it for safety. It's 1937, and over 100 people died from the administration of this. Now, to the FDA's credit, they recovered all of, but probably less than a liter of the actual formulated drug product. So it was quite a search to get it back. In 1938, they passed the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act to require safety testing. History repeats itself in a way. In 2007, more than 300 people died in Panama because of a formulation of a drug substance that was using diethylene glycol. And the reason that this happened is that the diethylene glycol was sold as glycerol. So it was mislabeled. Now, again, emtercaleat. It is up to the buyer to make sure that what they have, what you're using, is indeed what you've purchased and what you want to have in there. So we set specifications for impurities. You guys are familiar with these: residual solvents, structurally related impurities, elemental metals, which used to be called heavy metals, especially toxic compound and mutagenic impurities, which are used to be called genotoxic impurities. Mutagenic impurities is now the official buzzword. So you're familiar with these. I wanted to go through some of them real quickly. Again, you have three solvent classes here. One, two, three. The ones you want to avoid: benzene, carbon tet, things like this. The class two solvents, such that would include glyme, ethylene glycol, DMF, NMP, methylene chloride. And for the most part, 1,000 ppm is the highest level of those. But if you're going to be isolating your API, why not use class three solvents? Because they have a higher limits. The limits, of course, are based on the toxicity of the compounds. But class three solvent would be preferred of these. Now, there is a class four, which are compounds that are where they have the specifications are pending, or maybe the toxicity testing needs to be done. Nonetheless, and then there's, you could say that there are another set of compounds that haven't been included in any of those things. And you might have to wind up calculating permissible toxicity levels, limits for these compounds. And if you go to the FDA's website, you will see that these limits are laid out. And I just want to point out that the default limits are based on 10 grams per day of the drug substance. Potentially mutagenic impurities. The M7 guidance came out just this summer. It's a great improvement over what was there. They're talking about potentially genotoxic impurities. Note that they're stating that you need two in silico assays these days, and they should be by complementary software. Now, a lot of this software is set up to be based on the input. Garbage in, garbage out. So you need to be very critical of the database of compounds that go into the software and hence the analyses. In this guidance, they are encouraging control strategies. Chemical fate is a big deal for quality by design these days, and it's very important. And It simplifies what we do as process chemists a lot if we understand the chemical fate. And then from that, we can go into the QBD approach, and that makes things easier. The calculations, again, are based on the toxicity, the TD50, the toxic dose that killed 50% of the test animals. And in this particular guidance, they walk through the calculation for ethylene oxide. Now, also, what is probably more relevant to what we're dealing with, they talk about the levels for ethyl chloride and methyl chloride. The alkyl chlorides are in there, and that's been a big concern for a number of people. Very excellent book if you're interested in the issue of genotoxins from Andy Teasdale. Highly recommend it. So some functional groups that are flagged as genotoxins, I put up the laundry list here. You look at these compounds and you recognize that these are compounds that are going to form covalent bonds with the genetic material, if indeed they get there. Now, some of the compounds that are down here, that are missing from here, are the highly reactive materials like acid chlorides, because acid chlorides are going to be hydrolyzed in vivo. Or things like the acid chlorides may get intercepted by the endogenous nucleophiles such as glutathione. So some of the examples that are over here, perhaps some of the less familiar ones, aeroboronic acids have caused mutagenic responses in microbial assays. Same with the esters. The thiourea's have shown to be generate some toxicity for the cancer of the thyroid gland. So there's a number of things here to consider, and the list is only grows bigger. Setting the default levels for limits for the PGIs, the stage threshold of toxicological concerns, limits have been proposed, and these are actually more generous than they have been in the past. And these are good things to take a look at. The goal, of course, is to reduce the risk of cancer to 1 in 100,000. And all of this is done by assuming that you can extrapolate linearly back to extremely low levels. That's not necessarily a good assumption, but that is the working assumption, and that's the assumption that we have to deal with. And just to underscore this, the importance here of what we're dealing with, looking at parts per million levels of impurities is difficult. It requires a lot of analytical work to get the assays set up. It's not only is it difficult for the analyst, but it's difficult for the process chemist and engineer to control the level of the impurities down at these minimal levels. So the toxicity of the compounds, the toxic effect, better, depends on the dosage. Paracelsus, the dose makes the poison. Now, a lot of times, the toxicity is viewed differently by different agencies and according to different applications. And in applications, it depends on whether or not it is IV, intramuscular, or through ingestion. So I just wanted to put up some examples here to try to drive home this idea. Atrazine, an herbicide that we're well familiar with. Apples and, you know, kids. How dare you serve apples to our children in school if they've been treated with atrazine? You know, that type of an attitude. And if you look at it, you'd go, yeah, it's an aerolating agent. And if atrazine were around in an API candidate, then we would certainly be called upon to control it at very low levels or understand, do the tox screening to see exactly what the toxicity of it would be. DMF, for a while, the Food and Drug Administration was requiring extremely low levels of this solvent. like 1.5, 0.5 ppm. Meanwhile, the Food and Drug Administration was allowing DMF as a flavorant into things like muffins. Now, 5 ppm of DMF in a muffin is a much bigger dosage than 1.5 ppm of DMF in a drug substance. So take another example here, the isothiazolones. These compounds, where R is chlorine or hydrogen, are preservatives. They're in cosmetics and shampoos. You look at this and think, yeah, this is going to be a great Michael acceptor. It clicks out over here, and now you have something that could even bind twice to proteins. So it makes sense that this could be something that could cause allergic responses, rashes, and that's what some people have reported. And if you take another step back from it, you see that this is related to a marine antifoulant, which has pretty much replaced the tributyl tin oxide antifoulants that were used in paints for ships. So it makes sense that this could be pretty highly reactive. Now, the people who make shampoos and the likes, skin products, say, it's no problem. We can use this at 100 ppm. Okay. Let's go back to our friend mesityl oxide. And this is not a mutagen. Acrylic acid is not a mutagen. Yes, they're good Michael acceptors, but they get intercepted probably by things like glutathione. Epichlorohydrin, bisfunctional alkylating agent, should be pretty toxic. It is toxic, and you want to minimize and control the levels of it. If you hydrolyze epichlorohydrin, you wind up with chloroglycerol. And I was looking at the toxicity data that I found for these two, and the data that I ran across said that chloroglycerol is more toxic than epichlorohydrin. I can't believe that that's true, but that's what I found. Going back again to an herbicide, isoxaflutol has been proposed as an alternative to things like Roundup. And it looks pretty innocuous until you recognize that at neutral pH or higher, it opens up to give a compound here that is a very efficient chelator for iron. And that's how this works. And it has considerable toxicity for humans, but it's being proposed as another herbicide. Just to go back to that Roundup, chelates manganese. So this one chelates iron. So it is incumbent upon us to take a look at things and see, well, how is it that they interact? And for those of you with experience in biochemistry, you probably have a better understanding of what is going on here. And it can be very important. And also want to point out that metabolism, cytochrome P450, can produce materials that we don't expect. And the toxicity there can be considerable. One last example here for small levels of genotoxic impurities. This was in the presence of methanol, methane sulfonic acid can form methyl mesylate. This, of course, goes back to the story of nilfinavir mesylate and the ethyl mesylate that was found in batches. This is an equilibrium process. The more water you have, the less ester you have around. So it just makes sense. If you're going to do a crystallization of a methane sulfonic acid salt, put some water in there. And you're going to minimize the risk of forming the alkyl mesylates. There's some very nice work that was done by PQRI to sort out exactly what was happening here. Now, The story that I have gotten from the people who are concerned with regulatory and tox issues are that this is very nice work. It makes good sense. And the FDA was very interested in it until the data was all submitted. And then the FDA kind of said, well, that's nice. Thank you very much. Now, if you can control the level of your alkyl mesylates, then we expect you to control them to the level that you've already demonstrated you can meet. You know, let's just leave it right at there. So you can put up a theory like this all you want, but what's much more valuable is the data on the mutagenicity and the data on the levels in your drug substance.